students that produce videos for us and edit. So they're some of them are film studies majors. All of them have an interest in media. And there are a couple areas they want to hear from you about.
Awesome.
But do you have, like, how did you begin?
I hope I can help in any way, honestly. I'm not an authority in this thing, but I'll definitely do what I can to share some thoughts.
Cool. How did you get a start in media?
I got a start. I was a comic book artist when I was a kid. Grew up. I fell in love with Marvel Comics at the age of 12. I grew up in care, children's homes, and my foster brother was a comic reader. And one day, as you do as a sibling brothers, I borrowed one of his comics. And yeah, just fell in love with the excitement of just how you can create a new fantasy world that wasn't real. So it became a bit of a escapism for me. And I think, yeah, after reading and getting into comics, I just knew what I wanted to do with the rest of my life, which was anything that was involved with comics and involved with eventually animation and then film. So yeah, I started to draw. I've actually got one of my comics here. I'll show you a glimpse.
Sure.
Of what it looked like. I was showing it to someone the other day. Oh man, you're kidding me. So yeah, it was something like this. So we printed this and got it into Forbidden Planet. We didn't have them. This is noted, by the way. This is before the internet and everything. So we drew everything by hand and printed it. And then, yeah, basically managed to get it into Forbidden Planet, which is a comic book shop in the UK. And yeah, I think this was the beginning of everything for me, because it opened up the realm of possibility, what you could actually do with what you have up here in the area of your imagination and sharing it with people in the form of a narrative, in the form of a story that you have created, to invite them into a world that you have created. So that's how I got into it, really. Right? Yeah.
Well, that's one of the questions for today. Is like, how do you go about? You know, everybody has their own process in terms of writing and editing and directing. But what is your process in a narrative? Because if you want to just talk about what kind of films you've made, and then we could go into detail, like Malachi and various other films like that.
Yeah. So. I always say to people, whenever I tell them I'm a filmmaker, I always prepare to give them the disclaimer of nothing big yet. Because everyone thinks that a filmmaker is Steven Spielberg, right? Or J.J. Abraham, because that's the context we place a filmmaker in. J.J. Abraham, do you know that dude? He's a mate of yours, isn't he, Roy? No?
I think it's J.J. Abraham.
J.J. Abrams. Oh, yeah.
Abrams.
Okay. Forgive me. But so if you saw them as, yeah, being the high-end filmmaker, I'm a lot lower down. You don't always tell people that, you know, people always ask me, well, have you done anything that I've seen? And I wouldn't know what people have seen. But the type of films I've made have been, like, short films. I've worked on a lot of commercials, worked on a lot of things for like MTV, television. So a filmmaker can encompass things that you make that engage people. And it isn't always feature films. It isn't always what is in the cinemas. So a huge thing for me has been TV series, working in comedy, drama. I edited a 8-part TV series that got nominated for a few awards recently in the UK. Worked on music videos, just anything really. A filmmaker, you know, kind of encapsulates so much different areas, so much different genres. It's not just your feature filmmaker. So, yeah, does that answer your question?
So okay, that's good. Do you want to talk about? Because that's how I I knew you a lot through the Malachi film and your process of taking a short film idea and making it happen with very little budget, very little funding, and it did get some notice. It did get some acclaim.
Yeah.
Do you want to talk a little bit about that? Like, what was it like to make a short film with no budget
Yeah.
and over years of time?
It was exciting, no doubt. I look at Malachi as being a part success, part learning curve failure. In film, you can take your expectations, and if your expectations aren't fully realized, you can turn that into a lesson that goes on to be a stepping stone in the right direction. A lot of the technology we have today, from people like Thomas Edison and guys who gave us the phones, they basically would always count that they've achieved so much more from their failures than always their successes, because their failures fed into their successes. I feel I'm yet to have my success in terms of my huge, big block, feature
Yeah.
film
Well,
blockbuster.
I want to mention what some of that too, but what
But
was it for you as a filmmaker? It was your first film. I know it was your first film, Malachi.
yeah.
When you had the idea, what was it? What was your first idea about?
I was saying that to say that it definitely was a huge blessing for me and success in the area of teaching me that I could have an idea. I had a rough idea. Malachi was about a young boy who believed he caught the face of God on his video camera. And when he showed it to people, a huge light burst from the TV, and they basically saw an image of love that they never thought possible. And it started off as a short teaser, which I filmed with a couple of mates at church. And that basically won me an award of £50,000 to turn it into a larger project. That £50,000 turned out to actually be only training from the BBC and other things. I wasn't actually able to spend it on screen where I needed it to go.
Ah.
There's always a hook. But I was able to turn it into a half an hour short film. And I had like a premiere at the BAFTA's headquarters, which was exciting. And I think all in all, the overall process for me was understanding that it's possible when you can actually have an idea in the comfort of your bedroom or in the shower one day that becomes a script, that goes on to become a storyboard, that goes on to sell an idea that eventually becomes a short film. You realize the world of possibility is opened up to you. And I think that's what short films do. They actually offer you an opportunity to actually believe in yourself and believe in the ideas that you will create.
Very
So that's what it
cool.
did. That's what it did for me, I'd say, Roy.
Did you believe when you first got the idea that it would become a success or that it would actually get done? Did you have the confidence to bring it?
I did and I didn't. I think sometimes, they say that ideas are like opinions. Everyone's got one. And so what makes my idea more important than another person's idea? Or not important, but what would make an investor who's got £200 million invest in my idea and not the Matrix? Or invest in my idea and not a Harry Potter film? So you're always in competition for how your idea is gonna stand the test of time and also compete against other ideas that are wanting to be made instead of yours. So that's the biggest challenge, I think.
And it's also that encouragement that somebody sees even a tiny short film by you and goes, wow, here's 50,000. We want to invest in you in order to see that thing happen.
Yeah.
So that's really encouraging. I want to just there are some questions that the students have, but I want to just talk to you about knowing how I know you. You went from writing the short script and then you had a dream project and you may still have that dream project.
Yeah.
Do you want to Do you want to tell us about that in terms of what it is and how far you came with that? Because for a while it was like, ah, this might
Sure.
happen.
Sure. First of all, I should also just say, forgive me for not even saying this, that Roy, you are a huge part of my journey in regards to becoming someone who can believe in myself. No, serious, because at a time when I needed literally someone to offer me, and guys, he didn't pay me to say this, I promise you, but I put him down as I put Roy down as one of my mentors who actually believed in me enough to actually give me the opportunity to begin to exercise my craft. So Roy, thank you for that, genuinely.
Yeah, you got no problem, man. It was easy to do. You're really super talented, dude.
I think we
So,
work together really well.
tell me about just give.
My huge idea, it's yet to materialize into film. So I literally, for about the last 12 years, I've carried a burden of an idea. After watching, I fell in love with Lord of the Rings, and I watched Two Towers for the third time in a cinema, and I walked out with a vision for an idea for a film. And it was a feature film about the life of King David, done in a way that no one's done before. I'm very into the biblical epics, and I love the way, I feel the Bible became like my comic book. I read it and, saw a whole world within it that could be brought alive through film. And so I jumped into a journey to try and bring alive the story of King David, Goliath, the world's most famous giant, and his family. And I wrote a huge epic, and it became a trilogy feature film that hasn't been made. And I've had the idea go through hurdles up and down in regards to my journey to try and get it made. And I'm still 2020. Obviously, it hasn't been made because you guys don't know about it. But I've managed to get an opportunity with HarperCollins to turn it into a novel. So that's also a new, sometimes you have to pivot on your journey to find out where you want to get to. And so I've said quite peacefully that actually I feel I need to get it down in a written form. So let me write it as a novel. And then maybe one day someone else will make it into a film if I don't.
In that journey, though, can you, what were the ups and downs like? What was the, I know you took, as a writer, you went to study at screenplay fests, but you also had some really good interest from Hollywood through a producer. Not to give that producer's name or anything, but what was it like having near success, and talk about that part, just the being recognized part.
It's challenging, isn't it? I think you can be an overnight success, or you can be a long success in terms of the journey to success takes you a long time. I never wanted to be an overnight success, and I think I never have been, but I feel that like I had the opportunity to be. I'm now on that long journey and still working my way out. I'm grateful. You become grateful for your lessons. Like I said, a huge part of my journey has been understanding pitfalls and identifying them as not being the place you're going to lie down and be buried in. They're a pitfall that you climb out of with a lesson, having made you stronger for being in it. And so the film industry is a and it's a roller coaster. It's full of ups and downs. And you will, I mean, I've had projects, for example, where I've made a film, or clients, hired me to make a film for them, and I've made it and I've put all my energy and joy into it, and then it doesn't get the traction. You also now have the way by which you are, your ideas are valued by the world, and they're how many people have viewed it, how many people have commented, how many people have liked it. Social media has totally changed the game in how we understand metrics and how we work out whether our ideas are actually being received well by the public. Has it gone viral? Are people talking about it? And those are lessons also that I've learned from. But it's I like nowadays genuinely, and you can probably hear the theme in a lot of what I'm saying. I like to learn from other people's mistakes more than just looking for success stories, because sometimes success stories and people's, you know, if Elon Musk is always the measuring stick, you'll always come up short. So sometimes I think it's good to look at those who have tried, failed, and you know, eventually gone on to succeed, but you also need to learn from their failures, because that might be where you are going to get the most, you know, get the most amount of courage. Or else, what you'll, I think, if I wasn't prepared for my failures, I would have given up a long time ago and become an accountant or become an architect or something. And so, yeah.
Okay, cool. Do anybody have any questions right now? I know there were specific, like, I'd like to know about this, or I'd like to, you're welcome to ask.
So I was really interested by what you said about the story of King David and how you just had that vision for it, and you're now kind of in this long process of getting it kind of fleshed out. And I was wondering how you started going about putting that down, and if your background as like a comic book artist kind of influenced the way in which you did that for film.
Brilliant. No, thank you. So the first thing I did was, I remember I contacted creative friends that I knew who I could trust with the idea, and you know, tried to see if any of them wanted to come on board with me. And a few of them did, and one of them had the same vision off the back of me pitching to him. And that led to us working together as a partnership. My friend, you'll remember him, Roy, as a gentleman called Mark Evans. He's an artist, phenomenal artist. And film is collaboration. Film is eventually, you might start an idea on your own, but it will always lead to you collaborating with others to make, you know, a team effort. And so that led me to work with, get some storyboards done, get some concept art done. Because I was a comic book artist, as you mentioned, I specifically wanted to see imagery that reflected what was up here. Because it's always helpful to let your ideas breathe and let them breathe on page so you can actually see that you have something of worth. Because I feel if your ideas stay too enclosed in your mind, they can exist like they can be a perfect looking image in your mind that isn't realized. And when it's realized, you realize actually it's not as good as I thought. So getting it down on page and seeing how other people react to it is always a good idea. And so for me, that was, yeah, speaking to, I had a friend who worked for a comic book that was more successful than me, 2000 AD, and he was able to put some imagery together of how I, for example, depicted the characters of Goliath and how I saw the world and how I saw, you know, the David versus Goliath battle. And visually, it looked amazing. And I think we're like, yeah, this was like 2000, and I think 2003 I had the idea. So it's a lot older than I thought. Yeah, 17 years.
It's a
And I still
long
haven't
time
seen
ago.
anything reflected it. Sorry?
No, it was definitely a long time. You had that for a while.
2003, I think, yeah.
Yeah.
And every year that passes, it's always encouraging, because you watch a Game of Thrones and you watch 300 and you watch films that come out, and you always look out for, has anyone tapped into the idea that I had? And when you don't see what you imagined, you start to get, you get encouraged, because you realize that actually, yeah, I've still got a little bit of a novel idea here, a fresh idea that still needs to be realized.
There, what I loved about it was like, you know how we all have Bible films in our head, or at least I do, like from the 1950s, and this was like so far away from that it really just, it was very much like a Lord of the Rings kind of thing, and it had that scale to it.
Awesome.
When
I
were you
hope so.
surprised? Okay, I'll ask this one more time before. Were you surprised when people associated with Lord of the Rings on some level took interest in it?
Was I surprised?
Surprised.
Yeah, I guess I was. But at the same time, I was surprised by my surprise, because I shouldn't have been surprised, because it was a good idea, and it has stability, and it has credibility, and it just needs to be realized in order for it to really be recognized for what it's worth. But if you can imagine, the odds weren't really against Bible stories. Like, the Bible has become the world's most popular book for a reason. I mean, even if we're atheists or we don't believe in the actual credibility of the, you know, the being known as God, there's some great stories in that book that speak to so much different areas of, you know, what it is to be human, what it is to be good, what it is to be evil. Some real solid, you know, meta narrative stories and archetypal characters are in there, which I think is really good.
I still have the audio of your meeting with the guy from the Hollywood dude. It's still in my iCloud. And it's this in-depth, like, going into detail about what works in a screenplay and what doesn't. And also, not only in a screenplay, but in the business. And so it's really amazing conversation between the three or four of you. Any other questions?
Bro, please send me that. I probably buried that. I need to hear that again.
I will send it to you.
So you said you started out with comic books, and then you sort of moved into filmmaking and animation and things that, like, are more audiovisual centered. How did your process have to change when you were, like, changing media like that?
Great question. In truth, I felt that the process changed only in the area of perceived power or creative power. What do I mean by that? I learned the power of being able to take an idea from here and translate it into my hand and then obviously put it on paper. And when I got hold of a camera, I just had a different type of instrument, a different tool in order to actually convey my thoughts. And this was years before the iPhone or, you know, smartphones allowed you to film with a camera, to have a camera on your phone. I was a part of a documentary project, and part of the payment for me being on that documentary was they gave me a load of camera gear, and I went crazy. I shot everything that moved. I tell people I shot weddings, funerals, bar mitzvahs. I basically just taught myself documentary filmmaking through the use of this kit. And in truth, I actually, I wouldn't say I fell out of love with drawing, but I started to realize that, oh my gosh, if I had to choose between the two, I think filmmaking is probably more of the direction I want to go in rather than just drawing. And I know it would work different for other people, but for me, it kind of took that trajectory. And I specifically said, I think I shot about 50 weddings, teaching myself how to shoot something that I cannot control. Because I said, if, you know, whether I'm in Afghanistan on the war field shooting, you know, soldiers going to war, or if I'm in a wedding, I can't stop what's happening. It's documentary filmmaking. And so, I think I became a little bit of a self-shooter through the work I did with weddings. And I think it was a great small territory for me to learn the principles of having a client who wanted goals, having a client who I could then please and satisfy when I shot and I edited and I gave it to them and they cried or they paid me money or they laughed at the right time. It made me realize, wow, there's power here. There's power in being able to move people's emotions. And I use the word power lightly. You kind of get what I mean. I noticed how we can help interact. We can help people's emotions. We can make people move by how we capture a shot or the fact that we were there to capture the shot, where other people might have, you know, moved on because they weren't patient enough to wait for, you know, the father of the bride to cry and literally throw his arms around his, you know, son-in-law and stuff like that. And so it taught me what I needed to know in regards to the actual emotional technicalities of how to capture footage, which I didn't realize was stuff I really needed to understand if I wanted to go into film. I don't shoot weddings anymore, though. Yeah, it was a good starting ground.
Oh, I hear you.
I like that idea of like how much power you do have in moving your audience. And I'm sure that you're always thinking about like what they are looking for and trying to like meet their needs when you're creating your work.
Definitely.
Are there times when your idea feels much different than what your end result needs to be? And how do you reckon with that, where your idea might have to change in the process?
Yeah, I think it goes, it goes both ways in terms of your idea might be stronger than what your client expects, or vice versa. Your client might expect a stronger idea than what you've created. I tend to try and go for the other way in that. I had a music video, for example, that I had a song that a client wanted me to produce a video for. And I was happily challenged with trying to conceptualize the song into a visual format that would move an audience. It was a song that another music video director, I don't think, would have come up with the idea I had. And I was quite happy with how I was able to I pleasantly surprised the client, being the band, by the idea that I came up with. It all had something to do with a teenage girl, I think a toddler being knocked over by a drunken driver at the beginning of the music video, and us going through the journey of how the father of the girl forgave the man who knocked his daughter over. And by the end of the story in the narrative in the music video, I wanted to have people cry and be moved, because I wanted to reflect and show what forgiveness looks like visually, because that was the challenge I gave myself. And initially the client was like, this might go really bad, because there's, and obviously it might, if you show a child being, you know, killed at the beginning of a music video, a lot of people might turn off because it's too emotional. And I kind of felt, well, the way that I would visualize it and depict it and show it, I don't think people would turn off. I think they would be engaged and pulled in by the story. And long story short, it went really well, thankfully. And we had hundreds of people, you know, guys like writing in, like making comments about how the video is making them cry and how they're moved and they didn't know what was going to happen. I managed to, you know, tie in a number of different concepts. I tied in race relations as well. The father and the girl, you know, were a black family. The driver was a white guy. And at the end, to have, basically, I'll tell you the plot. In the prison, basically, the white gentleman's taken to prison, and he basically has been crying about this horrible thing that's occurred, and he sees the father of the girl that he killed come to the prison, and he's basically, the father's come to meet him, and everyone's expectation would be that the father's gonna, you know, have a go at him and basically try to attack him. But instead, the father basically hugs him and brings him close, and, you know, they both cry tears. And it was what I wanted to say to a culture that I feel is constantly having these tensions. I wanted to say that there is room for forgiveness, there is room for love and compassion, even though we as humans tend to look for the angst rather than the peace. And so, you sometimes, as a filmmaker as well, you celebrate the clients that allow you to make social commentary through their work. And I always say, I always respect the fact that it's their work, and if you're working for a client, you're there to help their project get more exposure by giving it a visual veneer, giving it a visual narrative. And so that works really well. And you can see that on my website, actually. That's it's a music video called Where You Are, on shabazzlgraham.com.
Yeah, I linked them to your website.
Oh, sweet.
We've got about 10, 12 minutes. Any other questions? Because I know there were a few. Okay. Yeah.
Hiya.
Hi. So I think you touched on this a little bit already, but I'd love to hear you talk more, if you're willing to, about how you kind of navigate filmmaking being work and also being like a passion, and how you kind of strike that balance between like it being something you're passionate about and also what you do for money.
That's such a good question. And the reason I laugh is because I'm, don't tell anyone, but I'm editing a TV series at the moment. Like as we speak, I literally just finished about just before I came on. And I'm counting the days down because it's a bit stressful. It's a children's program for Channel 5, and it's like 10 episodes of 10 minutes of, you know, it's a preschool program. And occasionally whilst editing, I'm like, dude, why am I doing this? I feel like I'm called to so much more. But you go through that challenge or that narrative constantly when you're working for other people's dreams, especially if they're other people's dreams that you don't necessarily believe in, but they keep internet, you know, flowing through my house, and they keep light, you know, and gas in my, you know, they pay the bills basically. So I think you have to have a little bit of a, you have to put aside some of your pride. Because if obviously I was like, if I told my wife, we're only going to be working for my dreams, and my dreams aren't paying the bills, then, you know, we'll easily be evicted. And so, yeah, I think there is a bit of a challenge in it. I use the work that I have to do to pay the bills to inspire me to ensure that I get my dreams paid for, by, you know, motivating me to actually get out of the 9-to-5 and get into doing what I want to do. But it's a long process, but it will happen one day. Watch this space.
Thank you.
No. What about, somebody asked about the technical aspect of, well, you asked about the technical aspect of filming, mm-hmm. or setting up a location. And I think you were asking about how do you, at the beginning of a project, yeah. especially a documentary.
Yeah. I can ask. It's kind of just like, how do you, I think you kind of touched on it a little bit already, but how do you go into it, like a project that is kind of going to be big? Like, how do you have that vision and kind of run with it instead of like what I do usually is I just kind of go out and try to get film and then create, you know, like what I'm going to do with it. So yeah, I don't know, like how do you go about that?
I think for me, I ensure that I have a through line that I keep, and by that I go to the end of the project and think, what do I want to be the takeaway from my audience before I get blown away by the technicalities, you know, parking permits for the, you know, the camera gear that needs to go here and all the other things which can help you actually forget your original intent. I'm sure to make sure that I know what I'm aiming for. What are the emotions I want my audience to leave the cinema or Netflix or whatever platform this film is going to be on? What's the emotion I want them to have? And how can I best create milestones in the journey of achieving that goal? How can I create milestones to ensure that I get that takeaway? Because the way that I see things, on a film set, there's only two original creators in truth. And that's the director and the writer. They have to be the visionaries that hold the vision together. Everyone is there to facilitate that original vision. And even the director, to some degree, he's serving the writer's original idea, but he's obviously adding, he or she, sorry, are adding their own flavor to it. So if I am directing or if I have written, I ensure, especially if I'm directing, I ensure that I know what the objective is so that at the end, everyone who is on set is looking at me to give them a good thing for their showreel. and so, yeah, I hope that answers it. But yeah, think of, and this is probably why I got into editing. I love editing because you need to know what's going to happen at the end of your project. And then you can obviously go back and create in an edit, for example, with the increase of, you know, media being what it is, people's attention span is so short that they might not get to the end. You know, you are up against everything on YouTube and everything on every social media platform. So now, have you noticed nowadays recently, there's almost a teaser at the beginning of film trailers. Have you noticed that? Like a little 5-second teaser. That's because they know that some people won't even get through a film trailer. And so they need to tease their appetite at the beginning. So normally that teaser is an indication of what's going to happen at the end. So, I tend to make sure that I know what's going to happen at the end and try to tease people as much as I can at the beginning to ensure that they stay with me.
That's really helpful. That's good. Really good. Anybody any other questions or anything to say?
I know that we only have a few minutes left, but I was wondering if you could really briefly go through the story of King David, because I think that sounds really interesting. And
thanks, dude.
That trilogy has only got 5 minutes.
It's a massive. You should. I would love for you to. He can send you stuff.
If you're open to that, I would love that.
Within reason, Shabazz.
Yeah, I want to get it done, man. I even feel that with the novel, I've had to put it down a little bit because, like the question before, I've had to focus on the day job a bit. But yeah, I can. Yeah, we can touch base offline, and I can share with you where I'm at. But yeah, long and short, but at the moment it's a huge world, and I don't know how Tolkien and these guys do it, but like, and it's probably why I really respect George R. R. Martin, the whole world of Game of Thrones. I think he's our modern day Tolkien, isn't he? And I sometimes think to myself, will I actually be able to finish it, because it is so vast and is so huge. But long and short of it, my goal is to just try and make it as unique and bespoke as possible, because I find that a lot of what I see in the area of trying to depict, you know, biblical narratives falls quite flat. I mean, you know, it's not really Braveheart when you really see a lot of the biblical epics that are out there. But one of my heroes is old this dude, old Cecil B. DeMille.
He's a hero of yours?
He's one of my heroes, man. Absolutely.
Oh my gosh.
He's one of
the culprits.
This is the guy that started Hollywood in regards to the Hollywood epic. Yeah. Check him out in terms of Cecil B. DeMille. He did like films like Moses, Ten Commandments.
Yeah, no, I think we know.
Everybody knows.
All right, cool. You good? Okay. Yeah. Any parting words?
What's your project, by the way? Are you guys working on a project, or are you overall just
we're working on the Book of Revelation.
Nice.
Inclamation form. No, we're working on a variety. They're working on a variety of documentaries, podcasts. Edward's doing a narrative film, which is really interesting.
Nice.
Sophie's working on a short film on one of the instructors. Nice. So it's a variety of things, kind of across the board of types of projects.
Brilliant. Well, I won't patronize you with any, you know, patronizing parting words, but I will just say all the best in what you're doing. And I look forward to seeing you succeed and achieve and learn from every mistake you make. And all the best with everything you're doing, genuinely.
Oh, great, mighty oak. Thank you. Listen, I want to put this on YouTube. I will cut out the Channel 5 reference.
Please, dude,
so that
please.
You're not, you know, I don't, you know, anything else that you think of that might not.
Yeah.
And let me know. But that's okay. The point is to put it on YouTube.
Maybe send me a cut before you upload it, and I'll point out anything.
You got it, yeah. And I will connect.
You told me that. I wouldn't have said it.
Uh, And everyone wants to be in touch with you. Is it okay for me to give them your email?
Yeah, sure. Shabazz at ShabazzLGraham.com.
Shabazz at ShabazzLGraham.
L. Graham, yeah.
L. Graham. It's the website, basically, yeah.
Like L. Right. Jackson.
Huh?
Cool. Like L. Jackson, Samuel L. Jackson.
Right. Shabazz L. Graham. Got it. Samuel L. Jackson.
I know we haven't got much resemblance. It's all good.
Man, all the best with your projects and stuff.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
That was awesome.
Thank you, guys. Really nice talking with you. Take care.
All right, see you later.
See you later, man. Take care.